assume, that's all. That will be Omnibus 15, because Omnibus 14 is closed. Can't hold anymore. And the roof is being done. And all of the ice is off of the 1980 Lincoln. Ooh, look at those icicles. And now we go get the 1993 Lincoln, because he's all been inspected. Ready to register. What a ripoff this is. You know, such a ripoff, this inspection and this insurance and this registration. Nothing but a ripoff. Greedy, 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 greedy. Everybody tries to get your money. What an awful way to spend your life. Stealing somebody else's. Folks, I never thought I'd buy a still camera for $100. You know, I'm a video person. But I had to have museum pictures of the museum to put in the living trust document. This is the living trust document. So we needed pictures in there to show what we're preserving. Well, I thought it'd be nice if we had pictures of it. And these photographs were developed in an hour at Walmart. They give you this nice plastic case. But that's a good picture, isn't it? This shows what the museum is. Well, Ken did a good job. That's the Pullman kitchen. Coffee machine. The, how many VCRs is it? Is it 10 or 11? Let me go over and look. 11 VCRs, the hallway, aren't these good pictures? And this is part of office 3 to the north, and this is more of the museum in office 3, and more of the museum in office 3, the boxes piled from the floor to the ceiling. This is the couch in Museum 3 with a Teddy Red Sweater and Sylvester Cat. And this is another view of the VCRs and the monitor. This is a mistake, but it's cute. It's a cat in her lazy boy chair, which may be going out today. This one didn't come out at all, so it's on another roll of film. This is desk 1, looking to the south. Well, I think that Canon does a terrific job. Look at that. Canon's really good. Look at that. The lazy boy chair is gone. Now, folks, what should we put there? We need a navy blue overstuffed chair, but we want it to be very small. Right? This is a cute little office chair that helped Franklin when he couldn't walk. And I would wheel him to the bathroom in this, and he could take care of himself. Sweet little office chair. Folks, I just talked to David Grossack, a great American hero in Boston, who has been onto this court corruption for years, and I told him about McDermott and the Supreme Court, that they were, the Rehnquist gang was just as dirty as any of the judges in the dirtiest and lowest United States District Court. And he says you wouldn't expect that after they'd risen through the ranks that they would still be clean, do you? And he's so right about that. And he said other things that I thought you should hear. But he didn't want to be on TV. He didn't want it to be on TV. But keep... Grossack had a pro se session. He's going to send it to you. So I'll play it for you on the TV so you can see it. The 1993 Lincoln got inspected yesterday. And in And the man who inspected it is a great fan of WRGB Channel 6. That's what he watches on TV, is Channel 6 WRGB. And he tells me that they're playing clips of Glendora because WRGB is having some kind of a celebration of an anniversary, and they go back to all of their old people that the public loved, like Earl Pudney and Bill Mulvey and Freddie Fryhofer and Friendly Fireman and all that. And they're playing their old personalities. And he says every two or three nights on the news he sees Glendora. So that's kind of interesting. We ought to get a copy of that, right, and play it for you. And now the 1993 Lincoln has to be registered. It's $55. You see, this whole thing is so unreal and such a ripoff, and it's nothing but political greed. And the money goes into their pockets. $55 to register it, and then they slap on $20 use tax. What's that for? Just to go into their dirty pockets. Our windows, folks, boards. It has something with the roof being cleared of shingles and letting them going down a chute. Boy, that man works hard. I just talked to Free Speech TV, and I didn't get you much information. A woman named Nadia was really not cooperative and not at all likable, and that's the first time. And so this week is sort of a bust on that. Their bus is not going to go out again until in a little while, I guess, a few weeks. It was sort of vague. And I asked them if they had anybody who was reporting on the deplorable condition of the courts, United States courts. And she said no. Nadia said no. So it was sort of a balk. We'll have to try them again someday. Free Speech TV on the Dish Network. Nadia did say that they had a thing on DirecTV called WorldLink. And what she said about it really didn't fit in with what I've been told about the FCC mandating 5% of the spectrum go to public interest.
And look what he did to my place.
You're a wonder how you do that all by yourself.
Oh. I thought maybe you're going to show that to the judge and he'll say, oh yeah, that's definite. There's no two ways about
it. Look at this mud hole. Isn't this great? Patrons of the United States Post Office. Look at that. Isn't that terrific? Isn't that terrific? Look at the camera. Look at the camera. This is lawsuit number, this is Omnibus 14. These are the Alpha defendants, MCI. So we'll do them, and then we do the Beta defendants, which would be Charles F. Dolan and Cablevision and all of his accomplices. Beta defendants, Dolan Cablevision. The MCI Alpha defendants are all done. They're in the envelopes ready to go. And Franklin is counting sets of 28. And it's like 200 pages. 28 sets of 200 pages. Dolan, lawbreaking, Cablevision, Systems, Corporation, his henchmen, who get paid for breaking the law. Where are we now? Omnibus 14, United States District Court, District of Mississippi. Started at 5:15 a.m. this morning. 3 hours and 3 quarters. 4.5 hours yesterday evening. Now, 28 sets of this has been printed from pages 31, 21 where Dolan starts, up to page 60. Here's 61 to 70, ready to print 28 sets. Put it away, rest, and pray. Running out of copy cartridges, talk to Tom DeLuca. He says he will UPS 2 of them today. They'll be here Monday. And I won't have to go to Staples, 31 miles over and 31 miles back. And it takes Tom DeLuca an hour to tell you all of the horrible things that are going on in his life. The Bronx Co-op, his former wife, his daughter, expecting. His son seems to be straightening out, although his son is going to be a lawyer, is trying to be a lawyer. That's pretty bad news. And then a stockbroker ripping Tom off for $30,000. Dishonesty. An hour. Moving on. Here's a picture. Bob Turner has arrived and has already gone up on the ladder to the roof. It's amazing how hard that man works. It's amazing that he does this all by himself. Lifts these big boards by himself. Wonder and amazement. Here's 4 copy cartridges going for refills. You know, this is all Dolan, mostly, and the other crooks in the courts, but most of them have come from Dolan. 9,000 hours protecting the public against the lawbreaking of Charles Dolan, protecting subscribers, protecting Yankee fans, protecting public access producers, protecting stockholders. So, the Let's take it to the post office before the post office closes at 1 o'clock. Do you like this chair here? It's something we could try out and think about. What do you think? That's the little old black office chair that helped Franklin so much. And then we have this one in here. It's kind of comfortable. Folks, I forgot to videotape for you one of the biggest things that went on today, and that was the progress on Glendora versus Charles F. Doran and Cablevision Systems Corporation for not returning a 52 VHS videotapes of a chat with Glendora, and for not paying, wasting the postage that Glendora sent Charles Doran and Cablevision to return them. And but even though we won the case, we didn't win the any relief for Charles Doran wasting our postage. No relief for that at all. We didn't receive the $3,000 ad damnum that we asked for, that you can get in small claims court. And so it's on appeal, and I've written the appellant's brief, and I was making out the note of issue and making out the statement pursuant to civil practice law, civil practice rules, New York State number 5533, I think it is, 31. And so it's all ready to serve on Charles Doran and on Cablevision. And when our lawyer friend comes up Thursday this week, we'll ask him to notarize the service. Franklin will serve it. He's not a party to the action. Okay, so that was one thing. And then there were some more medical cheaters, you know, medical ripoffs, ambulance service, doctors, and their great big x-ray machines, and Vasa Hospital, and Sloper Woolen Ambulance, and all of those people who ripped Franklin off and who ripped Medicare off. We've started the sixth letter to them. I should have shown it to you, I forgot. But this one I wanted you to see. In the Supreme Court of the United States, Washington, D.C., George Edward McDermott, petitioner, versus Andrew Clifford Moore et al., respondents, and on petition for a writ of certiorari, memorandum to the court clerk, William K. Souter, clerk of the Supreme Court of the United States. Dear sir, I am contacting your office in an official capacity, seeking an explanation into why my case file in your court was deliberately taken apart and purposely misfiled, resulting in an alleged denial of just relief to myself and my partners, as evidenced by your court's own attested docket exhibit 1. As exhibit 1 evidences, I visited your court on January 14th seeking a copy of the alleged order denying the relief requested, which would be a petition for writ of certiorari, only to find that the court had not corrected the case file in the above captioned case, as evidenced by Exhibit 2, which represents the total contents of the case file as of 4:45 p.m. January 14th, 2003. Petitioner also requested the true test certify copy of the alleged order of the court dismissing petition, but after a 15-minute search to such, no such document could be found, and petitioner was escorted from the building by security. The obvious items missing from the court's official case file jacket are as listed. 1, the complete petition for relief with the exception of cover page showing court date stamp, 45 pages are missing from the document. 2, also missing is any evidence of the 200-page lodged appendix filed in support of petition. 3. Also missing is any evidence of the partner's affidavits filed in support of petition. Exhibit 6. 4. Also missing any evidence of the second lodged appendix filed in support of petitioner's claim for relief, citing newly discovered evidence of, and rather not available when the petition was originally filed, containing 140 documents. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. Supreme Court of the United States is as tacky as any of the low United States district courts that I've encountered and I've reported about to you. Oh, this is going to make you sick, folks. You won't be able to eat your dinner. Folks, this is my protest against the Kellogg Company, which bought the Worthington Foods Company, which made Wham! A vegetarian ham that was delectable. And I miss it. And my cats miss it, and Franklin miss it. And they...
Hi, this is Rosemary. I'm away from the office right now, or on the other line. If you'd like to leave me a message, please do so at the tone. I'll return your call as soon as possible. Have a great day.
Recording.
Mr. Carlos Gutierrez, this is Glendora. Chat with Glendora and 36 cable TV systems across the country. I continue my protest against you for ruining Wham! Wham! Was a great product, and you just ruined it. And you won't listen to me, and you won't do anything about it. And you're a coward, and you run away, and you won't even talk to me. This shows that you know you're wrong. Every week on my program, I protest what you have done to Wham! Wham! Was a vegetarian ham, and it was delicious. You have made it inedible. My number is 914-949-9495. All your friends at church missed you.
Oh, thank you.
They were sorry that you, to hear that you were too weak to go.
Say, sorry, what?
To hear that you were too weak to go.
Thank you.
Yep. So I took communion for you. Since I have power of attorney. How do you feel?
About the same.
About the same?
Yeah.
Well, it could either get worse, or it could get better, or it could stay the same. We just have to wait and see. So what's going on here? Yep, we're wrapping. Send out 36 tapes to 36 cable DV systems. The in-mail pile of January 29th is going down. United States Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit, Cincinnati, Ohio. Glendora. Complaint of judicial misconduct. Number 6, they've only had 6 in this year. That would be they had 6 in January. Dear Glendora, this will acknowledge receipt of your complaint of judicial misconduct against United States District Judge Patricia Gaughan. Your complaint has been filed and is signed number 03637201. Please place this number on all future correspondence. In accordance with Title 28 U.S. Code 372C2 and Rule 3A of the Rules Governing Complaints of Judicial Misconduct or Disability, a copy of the complaint will be sent to Chief Circuit Judge Boyce F. Martin, Jr. I will advise you further upon the disposition of this matter. Sincerely, James A. Higgins, Circuit Executive, and Glendora. Memo endorses this. Thank you. You handle it well. Give him a raise. Yours in truth, Glendora. Chat with Glendora, February 2, 2003. This is Omnibus 10 lawsuit, Glendora versus Charles F. Dolan. It was brought in the United States District Court, Cleveland. A wretch of a judge named Patricia A. Gunn failed America. Before I read you the next foolishness from a United States court, let me tell you a joke. The girl said to the boy, I'm not going out with you Friday or Saturday night. And the boy says, oh, that's terrible. You've ruined all my plans. What am I going to do with my weekend? And she said, wear a hat on it. A little 13-year-old boy got a job with Jack Lemmon, the movie star, helping Jack Lemmon with his fan mail, and he liked the job. But then he quit because his little 13-year-old buddies called him a lemonade. Abraham Lincoln once walked 10 miles to return a book to a library. And now, in honor of Abraham Lincoln, we close the libraries on his birthdays. And the policeman stopped the motorist and said, what's your speedometer say? And the motorist says, it doesn't work. And the policeman says, how do you know how fast you're going? And the motorist says, well, at 30 miles an hour, it rattles. At 40 miles an hour, it shimmies. And at 50 miles an hour, it stops. And Billy says, Grandpa, how come my sister wears her blue jeans so tight? And Grandpa said, so she can fit into her compact car. Okay. Let's go over here to another foolish United States Court. United States. Thank you. That car. Okay. Let's go over here to another foolish United States court. United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit in Atlanta. And it says, we have received a complaint of judicial misconduct or disability. I crossed out the or and said and. From you regarding U.S. Magistrate Judge E. Clayton Schofield III of the United States District Court for the Northern District of Georgia. That would be the Atlanta court. It has been docketed under so-and-so and is being transmitted to the office of the Chief Judge pursuant to provisions of Rules 3 and 4 of Addendum 3. Oh, Glendora says, thank you. Correspondence pertaining to matters decided or pending in this court, which may be filed in the future in this court, may only properly be directed to the clerk's office. It is inappropriate for litigants to communicate directly with the judges of this court with regards to matters relating to their official duties. See Federal Rules of Procedure 45, Federal Rules of Procedure 45. And Glendora says, oh, and it's signed sincerely, Ed McElhenry. That's a nice name, though. Congress made no such law, says Glendora. Inappropriate arrogance, says Glendora. Clerks are not suffragan judges, says Glendora. Yours in truth, Glendora. Friday the 2th, 2003.
So here are some more jokes for you before we go on to other jokers and other joker courts. President Bush is like any man. He gets up in the morning and shaves, except that he shaves the budget. And Peter says they have a product in the supermarkets that he would like to have every time he plays poker. Oh, really? What's that? 2,000 flushes. A man said to his friend, how are you today? And his friend says, I'm able to keep my head above water. And his friend says that, yes, that's because wood floats. And the little boy says, the only kind of gum that I am allowed to chew is Trident. Why is that? Because it's good for your teeth? And the little boy says, no, because I only have 3 teeth. What does the mother say NFL stands for? What does NFL stand for? National Foolishness Live. Harry had a bad day in the golf course, folks. He threw his golf bag into the pond. He threw his golf clubs into the pond. He threw his golf balls into the pond. He came up to the clubhouse and he slit his wrists. And he's standing there bleeding to death. And his friend George came in, he says, hi, Harry, how about a game of golf tomorrow? And Harry put one wrist on top of the other and stopped the blood and says, what time? United States Court of Appeals for the 4th Circuit in Richmond, Virginia. And this is Glendora, plaintiff appellant versus John M. Walker, Roseanne B. McCacknate, Tynetta Hope, Helena M. Harris, Thomas F. Hogan, Denise Kelly, Kevin Smith, Joseph N. Alexander Jr., Colleen Kolar Cotelli, Nancy M. Mayer Whittington, Mary M. Schroeder, Kathy A. Catterson, Gwen Baptista, Karen Murphy, Chief Clerk, Nassau Supreme Court, Motion Clerk, Intake Clerk, John P. de Blasi, Barry Schwersky, Gerald Stern, Lee Kai Clear, Albert Lawrence, the New York State Commission on Judicial Conduct, the City of New York Department of Finance, Commissioner of Finance, Bureau of Parking Violations, defendants, appellees. This was Omnibus 13 lawsuit. It was filed, Glendora versus Walker et al. It was filed in the United States District Court of Charleston, West Virginia. The robber judges were Copenhaver, John T. Copenhaver, and Mary E. Stanley. And the appeal from the United States District Court for the Southern District of West Virginia at Charleston, in accordance with a written opinion of this court, filed this day, the court dismisses the appeal. And then the mandate comes along. Well, there's nothing you can do except, since they don't deal with the merits, there's nothing you can do, you just sue all this gang over again. And then you add the judges and the Fourth Circuit so-called judges as defendants. One of these came up from Richmond and one of these came up from Charleston. So, yeah, they make it sound so big and so official when they're such a bunch of crooks. It's a license to steal. The city of Rye requires a public access producer to go out and get a local resident to sign this paper. Or otherwise they will not cable cast the public access show. And so I asked Peter Lane, who is a city judge of the City Court of Rye, if he would sign the paper to put the program on TV. And this letter was received by Glendora on January 29, 2003, Anno Domini, and memo endorsed by Glendora on February 2, Groundhog Day. And Peter Lane says, or Mary Jo Garrity says, this is in response to your request to Judge Lane regarding the above matter. Since you have been a litigant before Judge Lane on several occasions, it would be inappropriate for him to endorse your application or to otherwise be involved in sponsoring your program. And Glendora writes back to Peter Lane, well, one, thank you, and two, I have four signers. Three, I have asked many judges I know in other municipalities to sign, not one has. Glendora takes exception to your turning this into a court matter. It was a personal matter. It should not have gone through the court. United States District Judges Foley Square commit this abuse promiscuously, having personal matters handled by the clerks. What did the lady say to the taxi cab driver? Can you back up 2 miles? I don't have enough money to pay for this. Glendora. And all of the legal papers are up to date. There are 9 of them. And that leaves words and highest and the living trust and network TV daytime, the jokes. Meditate. Red calls. Try to find somebody with the money to advertise on channel 247. Green calls. Try to find somebody with enough money to advertise on the Super Bowl next year. And that should be you, Green Parrot. You're a Green Parrot. Green calls. Here they go, folks. Another 20 hours work. Franklin just sent $4 to Wider Church Ministries, United Church of Christ in Cleveland. And I
asked them to be the local signer for a chat with Glendora in Cleveland. You know, when people ask me, what is your show about, I should tell them it's a comedy show. It's about what happens in the United States District Courts. Manhattan Neighborhood Network. The renewal. It's very easy. It's a whole lot easier than that stupid Cablevision. My signer in Manhattan is Cy Amlin, a former vice president of ABC Network Television. He was an assistant for Silverman, the man who got ABC ratings of significance for the first time. Manhattan Neighborhood Network is presenting a symposium on a documentary made by a young producer named Katz, and it's a documentary of a lynching. Isn't that a horrible thing? Oh, it's so horrible. And then Manhattan Neighborhood Network, if this information isn't changed, you don't have to send back this form. Cy Amlin is, I say, the local signer, Cy and Elner Amlin, and they live on Riverside Drive, and it's the last place where Babe Ruth lived. And Manhattan Neighborhood Network is offering daily programming from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. You can have a daily public access television show. Isn't that great? A weekly is enough to inter me. But I think it's wonderful that the opportunity is there. We're getting through the in-mail of January the 29th. There's just one left over there. You see the weather we're having? It's above freezing. And it's thawing. And it's melting. And the sky was a clear, beautiful blue, azure blue. Do you think we should have, I think we should ask the landlord to have hooks so we can have some hanging plants. That hook was already here. But put a hook there for a plant and a hook there for a plant. And a hook there for a plant, and then put three here. Three, have three hanging plants there, and have three here. Do you think that would be nice? See if he wants to put holes in the ceiling. His ceiling and walls are very nice, in good condition. Isn't that amazing, this geranium in the middle of January and February, blossoming its heart out. There's the fourth blossom. Isn't that great? And this is the plant the landlord was going to leave to die. We have 13 plants here, 11 plants here. And this one we're going to take to the Reformed Church plant sale in Hopewell in May. And we're going to ask $10 for this. I really worked hard bringing this plant to its beauty, to its luster. Well, there's $10 worth of hard work in there, but millions of dollars worth of God work in this plant. Do you notice it has purple backs? Look at that. Isn't that pretty? A husband says, well, why do you talk to your plants? And the wife says, you're supposed to talk to your plants. And he says, well, I never heard any one of them answer you. And she says, well, that's because they're mums. And another woman says, I have one plant that I won't speak to. He thinks he knows everything. Isn't this something in February? Groundhog Day? Now that's a beautiful creation, the color, the flavor. The shape, it's just beautiful. It's interesting that the fruit that you buy rots before it ripens, but this is almost ripe, and it's delectable. The woman asked her cleaning woman, why do you take the cantaloupe shells out of the, why do you save them? What do you take them home for? And the cleaning woman says, it makes my garbage look so fancy. Here is the last piece of work that came in, number 11, January 29th, and this is Glendora's stock certificate for Comcast. As you know, AT&T let all of its cable TV systems go to Comcast, and at first it was going to be AT&T Comcast or Comcast AT&T, but AT&T decided to drop out of it. So now it's just Comcast Corporation. And this piece of stock cost about $25. And it comes from RBC Dane Correspondent Services, whatever that means. Tom DeLuca told about a stockbroker who ripped him off for $30,000. He lost $30,000 to this stockbroker. The stockbroker engaged in unauthorized transactions, and Tom is going to sue him. The stockbroker is in the Bronx, and I know his name. So there is all of the in-mail done. In-mail table is clear. Franklin stayed in bed from 9 p.m. last night to noon. I told him that was degenerate. And I helped him get up. No more of that. He's not even sick. Look at that down there, folks. See? It's melting. It's thawing. It's going away. Isn't that great? Groundhog Day.
What the woman say to the taxi cab driver? What? Can you back up 2 miles? I don't have enough money to pay for this. Have a good night.
Must be getting colder out. The windows are steaming up. I asked 35 people this morning if they had the money to buy an ad on television for $3,000 on the Big Time Channel 247, Big Time TV. And there's no backlog on Meditate, Create, and half of the bottom think drawer is done. And what is this? I'm looking for somebody with $1 million who can sponsor the Glendora Cheerful Look at Life. 1 minute of jokes on NBC or ABC or CBS. There's 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. There, I asked 50 billionaires if they had $1 million to sponsor Glendora Cheerful Look at Life on NBC, ABC, or CBS television network. How many is that all together? Since the project started last summer, I would say that's 310 billionaires. And they are very nice people. We call the companies. I should play you some of these recordings. For instance, Warren Buffett. How nasty his office is. These billionaires corrupt the youth of America. They turn them into savages. I thought I'd go up to Pine Plains and see if we can cut the rent. Get the rent down to $550. Thank you. sister is doing a funeral. People, a lot of people die. Look at that, folks. Okay. Is that dirt? Nope. That's snow. Okay, I want you to give me a date. When will that be a puddle? When will that be just a wet spot on the pavement? I'll say April 15th, income tax day. What do you say?
Store.
Oh, and I know you. One day when I had that awful...
The beautiful hats.
Yeah.
What's up? What are you taking?
That snowstorm. How? When do you predict that that will be melted? That pile of snow?
Oh, I don't know.
I predict April 15th.
By then, definitely.
Yeah. Small country road. Rusty and I used to come over this road at night. Can you imagine? In the rain. Oh. This is the end of it. Here's this little tiny bridge. And a snowmobile. And a creek. The creek is flowing. It looks very pretty and clean. That was Beekman we came out of and going into Stormville. Dutchess County, state of New York, United States of America, Northern Hemisphere. It's been a Stormville winter, hasn't it, folks? Every place is Stormville. Wowie. Oh, that's cable vision. Yuck. This train comes all the way up from Grand Central Station, isn't that something? But boy, I don't know. There's plow banks up against the railroad tracks. Guess I'm wrong about that. Stormville Mountain. That's part of that Taconic Range that I keep showing you down at Walmart. It goes west and east, east and west. say if Charles Dolan had stopped persecuting public access producers. Bill next. Peck spill. Look at that ice. Look at that for ice. Patterson, New York. The Baptist Church. It's on TV. Nice church service.
John Kennedy.
And of course, Edward Kennedy. Patterson, New York. Don't you think it's a charming little town? Patterson, New York. Patterson Village, Patterson Town. Putnam County, State of New York. USA.
Nine.
a message to the new chairman?
No, I can put you through. Can I have your name?
Yes, Mr. Green.
Mr. Green?
Yes.
Okay, and your company?
Is Green T.A.
Green
T.A.? Yes.
Okay, hold please.
Thank you. He's retired. Last time I called, it was said that he's no longer with the company.
And it was his company. He started it.
This is Adelphia Communications.
Hi, this is the voicemail of Susan Anderson. I am in the office today. Please leave a message and I'll return your call as soon as possible. Thank you. Recording.
Please call Mr. Green, 914-949-9495. We want to know if Adelphia wants to buy an ad on the Super Bowl. It's $3 million, 60 million viewers, and it includes videotaping the commercial.
This is a rest area on Route 84 going west, Stormville, New York. The business at the bank is all done, folks. I didn't tell you the joke about a man who put an ad in the newspaper for a secretary, and there was, after a while, heavy knock at his door, and he opened the door, and here's this great, great big dog, and the man said, "You're answering the ad in the newspaper?" And the dog says, "Woof." And the man says, "Well, can you type?" And the dog sat down, and he typed 85 words in a minute, not one mistake. And the business owner says, "Well, can you take sure hand?" When the dogs took 120 words in a minute, typed it all up, handed it to the owner of the business, not a mistake. The owner of the business says, "Well, another thing I need is, are you bilingual? Bilingual?" And the dog said, "Woof, meow." Lori Galgano called and said that she found a signer for a chat with Glendora in Ellenville, and it will go on twice a week right after her show, The Hidden Truth. I think it's Tuesdays and Fridays around 8:30 or 9:30. Next call that I have to play you folks is from John Figliozzi, the Public Service Commission, State of New York. As you know, Cablevision has been violating the laws in Milliton and Amenia and Stanford and Pine Plains and Dover Plains
and Millbrook, and Washington, the state of the town of Washington in Dutchess County. For years, they've never had any public access. And so Glennie came along and said that that was not right. And she addressed the Public Service Commission with this complaint, and the Public Service Commission agreed with her. And it's been weeks since she did address the Public Service Commission. It's been weeks, months, almost a year since she addressed Cablevision with no public access in Wingdale, the so-called Wingdale system. So, here, this next recording. Listen to this. Hooray, 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 hooray. Another victory for public access. So you go out, you have to buy all these things, you get all these receipts. Then you come in, and you have to enter everything in the diaries. The fourth week, the fifth week of January, the business, and then the personal. Oh. Then you have to take every entry and put it over here into the column, and it goes telephone, technical equipment, printing, postage. Postage this month, outrageous, $167. The rent and gasoline, $98. Car repair, $1,249. Comcast stock, $53.64. Donations receipted, $98. Donations unreceipted, $55. And then the groceries. Groceries were $3.41. Household, laundry, clothes. Then you have to take every one of those columns and put them in the end of the month, or rather the end of the year. And you have to title all these columns and start up January. Oh, what a lot of work. And now I got to put in all of those things there that were spent yesterday. This is Bob Angelo in Cornwood.
Well, I've kept copies of everything, so I know that's at least, I know from my past experience with all these things that I better do that. So what I'll do is I'll ship you off. You said everything goes to you, right?
Yeah, I would send it to me.
All right, I'm going to send it out again. That's all I can say.
All right, now you're doing two renewals, the one for this first quarter.
Right.
I hope they haven't taken it off the TV yet.
Yeah.
And then you're doing the one the second and third quarter.
Right. And right. Then, yeah, I remember.
And then we won't hear from those bums until August, so.
That's good.
So that'll be good.
Yeah, that's
so
good.
So it's two sections.
Yeah, I remember this too.
Okay.
I know there was two that were going to go to different,
okay.
But we sent them directly to you.
I'll tell you a joke about the doctor said to Harry, you mustn't shovel snow. You'll have a heart attack. And Harry went home and he said, son, will you shovel the snow, please? And his son said, yes, Dad, I'll start immediately, and that made Harry have a heart attack.
Are you laughing at that, huh?
I'm laughing because you can't win.
I know.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Bob.
Bob Angelo in Thornwood. This is the signer for Chat with Glendora in Ossining.
system that goes way, way, way down to Terrytown. In mail of February 5th, 8 details, donations, and 4 legal papers from inept and traitorous United States District Courts. Millstorm number 20. Robert Yeoman did a beautiful job shoveling off the stoop. I have a pet deer. She's big. She's beautiful. The roof is still going on. The roofing is still going on. And this is 3 inches of snow on top of 2 inches of ice. The Arctic tundra. Again, folks, snowstorm number 20 since November. 6 more weeks of winter. And it crunches under your feet. It's so cold. Cold, snow, ice. Katie says no to it. No. Right? Hey folks, this ends up another 2 weeks of videotaping in the life and times of a public access producer. I called DirecTV yesterday and asked them if they had anything that was analogous to Free Speech TV, which is on the Dish Network. And they had a hard time finding anything, so I'll have to call the office of the CEO and get the information on that and report it to you. That was a great victory over Cablevision. Here, Cablevision in Millerton, Pine Plains, Dover Plains, Millbrook, Armenia, Stanford, and Wingdale, and a whole bunch of other municipalities has failed to have public access all these years. And the state law is very clear on it. If you have X number of subscribers and they have 10 times that X, you have to have public access. And they've got away with it all these years. Until Glennie came along and Franklin signed the papers. And so you heard that telephone call from the Public Service Commission, John Figliosi, that somebody from Cablevision would be calling us this week, past week, to give us the time and the dates and the channel of The Hidden Truth and A Chat with Glendora. And I have fought this for 9 months, and these people should be fined, as the law says, $10 a day for every day they violate the rules for public access, cable television. Franklin is losing capacities. It's very hard now for him to grasp anything. You do this 1,000 times a day. You just be thankful that you have it. I tell Franklin that we're doing okay. Excuse me. Here's a bunch of obituaries, and they list the person's name and the age. And it's 71, 82, 66, 64, 74. So you see, we're doing okay. Franklin's 83, and I'm 74. 64, 63. I have to tell you about the businessman put an ad in the newspaper to get a secretary. And a couple of days later, there was this heavy knock on the door. With some of that ice is caught in my throat. And here was a great, great big dog. And the businessman said, "Are you applying for the secretary's job?" And the dog said, "Woof." And the businessman says, "Can you type?" And the dog sat down. That's a typewriter. And he typed away for 1 minute, 85 words, and not a mistake. And the businessman said, well, can you take shorthand? And the dog says, woof! And the businessman threw out 120 words in a minute. And the dog sat down, typed it all out, handed it to the man. It was perfect. So the businessman says, there's one other thing I need. Are you bilingual? And the dog said, woof, meow. I have been 9,000 hours since 1983 fighting the law-breaking of Charles F. Dolan and Cablevision and all of the crooks that he has working for him. That's 9 years, $9,000, 9,000 years. 9 years, 9,000 hours. And I'll tell you the number of dollars, too, later. That's 1,000 hours a year that I resisted and stood up for right against Charles Dolan and Cablevision and all of their mean things that they've done to the public. The New York Yankees, you subscribers, public access, and shareholders. Answer a question for me, folks. Why doesn't Charles F. Dolan want me, a shareholder, to see the books when I have a statutory right to see these books, both in the state of New York and in the state of Delaware, where Cablevision is incorporated? How many dollars? It's $25,000 in court fees, stenographer fees, postage, printing, traveling, tolls. Now this is interesting. Look at this. This is from a little town named Stanford, okay? In Dutchess County. And here you got a judge of the town, a town justice so-called, suing the town board and the town supervisor. Isn't that a riot? It's good, good, good. There's a lot of solidarity there, but that's good. Break up this solidarity, because it's crooked. Let's see what else there is to tell you. I guess there's nothing else to tell you. You've got to make a living trust, folks. You know what a living trust is? Now, a living trust is not a new concept. It goes way, way, way back to the medieval days, the kings of England and the nobility who wanted to hold on to their property so the kings wouldn't get it. And you make a living trust while you're living. And you become the trustee of that trust. And you control all of the assets while you are living. And it's revocable while you are living. It can be changed and amended any way you want. But the minute you die, it becomes irrevocable. And you appoint a successor trustee to take care of things when you get disabled. Or when you die. And then things are done the way you want them to be done. Now, in a revocable living trust, you have a pour-over will, a will that says anything that you have that you might have forgotten to put in the trust is to go into the trust. If you don't have your assets assigned before you die, they go to probate. And there goes lawyers' fees, judges' fees, judges under the table, and there goes guardianship fees, and there goes everything you want. I mean, you have everything they want. So you've got to do this. And it's very simple to do. It also includes a power of attorney, a special power of attorney for transferring all of your assets to the living trust. It also is a health proxy. And another good thing about it is that it organizes things before you die or before you become disabled. It organizes things. So you must do it. And ours is just about done. Everything has to be taken care of now by you, the way you want it to be done. It's a lot of work, it's distasteful at times thinking about dying, but then it also helps your attitude toward dying. You're ready to face it more, I guess. Okay. So I guess that's everything for this past 2 weeks on a chat with Glendora. Lori Galgano called up and said that she got a chat with Glendora on cable TV in Ellenville. That's run by Time Warner and by the same people, Rick Haddard, who runs Middletown, New York, cable TV, public access. Okay, so some jokes. The girlfriend said to the boyfriend, I am not going out with you Friday or Saturday night. And the boy said, you upset all of my plans. What am I going to do with my weekend? And she said, wear a hat on it. A 13-year-old boy got a job helping the movie star Jack Lemmon with his fan mail. And he liked the job very much, but he gave it up because his little 13-year-old buddies kept teasing him that he was a lemonade. Abraham Lincoln walked 10 miles to return a book to a library. Now we honor him by closing the libraries on Lincoln's birthday. The policeman said to the motorist, what's your speedometer say? And the motorist says, it's not working.